know about you guys, but I was blessed by that this morning. Amen. It's awesome. I don't know, just in my life alone, it's just been a blessing to have family members like that leading me and kind of guiding me along the way. It kind of leads into what we're talking about this morning. So, like I said, I'm Pastor Nick. I'm the youth pastor here at the church. Like I said, Jason's out of town, and tonight, or this morning, I'm going to bring the message this morning. So, if I seem a little nervous, it's because I am. It's not an act. I'm much more comfortable sitting on a stage in front of teenagers and in front of adults and stuff like this, so it's a bit of a stretch, but I don't know, I consider it an honor, I consider it a privilege to be able to stand in front of you this morning, and I pray that your minds and your hearts are open to hear what God has, because I believe that God has given this message to me, and I believe that God has kind of blessed this, and I believe that it's for somebody here today. Actually, I believe it's for all of us here today. But to open, actually, it's kind of a little bit old school, but I want to open with a passage of Scripture. And it's in John chapter 21, verses 12 through 17. If you guys have your Bibles, you can turn there. If not, it's going to be on the screen. It might be a little bit different than what I'm reading, but it should be close enough that you should be able to follow along. Jesus said to them, "Come and have breakfast." None of the disciples dared ask him, "Who are you?" They knew it was the Lord. Jesus came, took the bread and gave it to them, and did the same with the fish. This was now the third time Jesus appeared to his disciples after he was raised from the dead. When they had finished eating, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you truly love me more than these?" "Yes, Lord," he said, "you know that I love you." Jesus said, "Feed my lambs." Again, Jesus said, "Simon, son of John, do you truly love me?" He answered, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said, "Take care of my sheep." The third time he said to him, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" Peter was hurt because Jesus asked him the third time, "Do you love me?" He said, "Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you." Jesus said, "Feed my sheep." Would you pray with me one more time? God, I thank you so much for your word. I thank you so much for your truth. And God, I just ask your blessing upon this message. I pray that the words that come out of my mouth aren't from me, but they're from you, and they're ordained by you. God, I pray you would just, God, once again, open up our minds and our heart. Help us to have ears to hear and hearts to understand and just apply this to our lives as well. We love you, and we thank you, and it's always in Jesus' name. Amen. So this week, we're going to continue our series on Soul Shift. It seems like it's been going on for a long time. We've had a lot of breaks with different programs and Bible school and all this stuff like that, so it's been kind of stretched out a little bit longer than what was intended. But I've really been challenged by the series myself, and I hope you guys have been too. If you've missed it out throughout the series, we've been looking at fundamental changes that must occur in the lives of every person calls themselves a Christian. So the good news is, if you're here this morning, this message applies to you, this series applies to you, if you call yourself a follower of Christ. If you've made that decision to make Jesus Lord of your life, these are changes that should be happening in your life. And we've gone through a whole bunch of, we've gone from the shift from me to you, kind of changing that focus from inward to outward. We've gone from seen to unseen, that focus of focusing on eternal things instead of the worldly things that are around us. Slave to child, and just kind of developing that relationship with God that it's more than just this demanding God figure, but it's a Father who loves us and cares for us and wants the best for us. Consumer to steward, just talking about giving everything that we have over to God. Yeah, go ahead. Sorry, I forgot to dismiss the children. Rookie mistake. I believe it's all children's age brackets this morning. So. While we have a little break, just kind of, it's a little, this message has been a little challenging for me because we've been doing this along with the youth group. And I've been a week ahead of everybody because you guys had some different things going on. So Wednesday night, I actually had to give a message to the teens, this actual same message. But I didn't want the teens to come on Sunday morning and have the same message that they got on Wednesday night. So it was really hard for me. I was trying to design two messages based on the same chapter and the same scriptures. And I was trying to come at it from a different angle and stuff like that. So it's been kind of a challenge for me this week, but I think it's been good for me. It helped me kind of break things down a little bit. So I'm going to do my best to kind of present in a fresh way for the teens that are there, but also in a way that we can give all the necessary information to you guys today. But anyway, like I said, we've been going through this Soul Shift series and talking about these changes at the fundamental level. When we go through it with the teens, I ask what it is, and I broke it down for them. Kind of like the soul of us is our inmost being, this eternal part of us. Right? A shift is just a change. A shift can be something big, it can be something small, it can be something quick, it can be something long term. But a soul shift is just this change in our inmost being. Right? It affects our perspective and our behavior. Right? it's changed our focus on our hearts, our perspective, and behaviors. And this week, the shift we're going to cover challenges all of them. Some of the weeks focus more of our perspective and how we look at things, how we view things. Some of the weeks have focused on how we live our life, how we actually live these things out and practice them in our day-to-day lives. And some of them are just hard issues. Right? But this week, I think it's unique and it challenges every single one of them. The shift this week is entitled Sheep to Shepherd. Sheep to Shepherd. And we read that passage before, and it's one that you guys have probably heard about a million messages on if you've been around the church long enough. But I hope that kind of this lays it out in a lot different way, a new perspective for you guys. When you look at Scripture, there are many verses that talk about God as a shepherd and us as a sheep. If you turn your Bibles to Psalm, actually, Psalm chapter 79, we have a couple different verses we're going to read. I'll just read it off the screen. I'll read the same thing. It says, "We are your people. We are your very own sheep. We will praise you forever. For all time to come, we will keep on praising you." For the director of music, I don't need to read all that. It says, "We are your people, we are your very own sheep. We will praise you forever." Psalm 95, 6 and 7. "He is our God. We are the sheep belonging to his flock. We are the people he takes good care of. Listen to his voice today." Psalms 103 says, "I want you to realize that the Lord is God. He made us and we belong to him. We are his people. We are the sheep belonging to his flock." One more, it's a famous one. Psalm 23:1. "The Lord is my shepherd. He gives me everything that I need." Like I said, this week is unique. Because if you looked at all the shifts that we've done previously, it's like a shift from one trait to another trait. And the previous one being one that's almost negative. It's viewed as like this negative light. It's like from me to you, it's like focused like we're selfish people. We need to work on being selfless. And it's like shifting from this negative trait to this positive trait. But this week, I think it's very different. If you look at Scripture, there's so many verses. This is just from Psalms, and there's many more in Psalms we could pull from, and many more throughout the Bible, in Old Testament and New Testament as well, that reference us as being God's sheep. And what we learn from this, I believe, is that this shift's different. When we look at these verses, when we look at many others, I think it is clear and it's important to clarify before we start that following God as a sheep is a good thing. This isn't a shift from something that's bad to something that's better. This is a shift from one thing just to another in our life. We need to remain this while also developing something different in our life. Following God as a sheep is a good thing. We should be obedient. We should be devoted to God and follow his lead and listen to his voice in our life. When we were in youth group moments, we just talked about sheep and just kind of how stupid and dumb they are and how they're dependent on somebody for everything. They're dependent on everything that's necessary for life. They need it from somebody else, and that's the shepherd in their life. I think it paints a good picture of who we are as Christians. In American society today, I don't think we don't really realize that we need him. And I think the song that they sung was kind of interesting to this point here, and it applies to this point too. As a Christian, as a church, we need to realize and kind of go back and realize our dependence and our need for Jesus as our shepherd. We should be obedient and devoted to God and be willing to follow and lead. Follow his lead and listen to his voice. And like it says in Psalm 23, even if it means walking through the valley of the shadow of death, we need to be the sheep that know his voice and are willing to follow him wherever he leads. However, when you look at the rest of the Bible, I think it's very clear, especially when you start looking at what Jesus said when he was here on the earth and what he was teaching, right? Following God in this way is not the end, but it is the beginning of our relationship with God. So following God as a sheep is a good thing, but following God as a sheep is not the end. It's not the end all. It's not the result that we're going for. It is the beginning of our relationship with him. I think the big problem that we have when making the shift is it's found in our reasoning and the reasons why that we follow. If you take a look at the original disciples when God called them, their decision to follow Christ was simply out of a response to his call. Jesus walked up to them. They're in the middle of their daily lives. They're in the middle of doing what he had called them to do. They were just out there, he was out there fishing. They were doing what they were doing every single day. They were making their living. They were just doing what everybody else was doing. And Jesus walked up to them and he says, "Follow me." He didn't say, "Follow me and this. Follow me and you will get this. Follow me and you'll get this in return." There was no preconceived ideas. There was no preconceived notions. Jesus just walked up to them and out of this divine call, Jesus said, "Follow me." And that's what they responded to. And they made this decision to dedicate their lives to his teaching, to leave behind their family, to leave behind their friends, to leave behind their work, to leave behind everything that they had to follow after this Jesus who had called them. And I think this is the place a lot of times we get stuck in Christianity, because many people follow Jesus for what they get in return. When you look at Christianity, it's kind of like this give and take relationship. And our problem is, we present Christianity then as a cure for our sin, and or a guarantee for heaven, instead of a divine call to follow Jesus. I hope that makes sense this morning. Our problem with Christianity today, and the biggest problem we have in making the shift, is that our idea of Christianity is skewed. The primary end result for Christians is, I want to be forgiven for my sins, and I want to be guaranteed heaven. And I believe that's true. That is 100% true. You can look it up in Scripture. That is part of it. But it is the beginning of our relationship. That is not the end result of our relationship. Because the problem is, if this is our perspective and this is where our lens is at, if this is what our Christian relationships are, this is what our relationship with God is, then there's no purpose and there's no reason to do anything beyond that. Once I've done A, B, and C to guarantee that I'm saved and guarantee that I've gotten to heaven, what's the point of doing anything else? There's a phrase I heard a lot of times growing up, when somebody would do something really nice for you and you weren't really planning on paying them back, like, God's going to give you an extra jewel in your crown in heaven. Right? Add an extra addition onto your mansion. Right? Anything that you do above and beyond just getting saved and doing the basics is like some type of benefit that you'll reap once you get to heaven. But as long as you got this and this covered, you're good to go. Anything extra is just the jewel in our crown, if this is what our perspective is. But when you look at the original disciples, it's clear that the Christian journey is intended to go well beyond assuring our own salvation. If you look at their lives, if you look what they did, if you look what Jesus taught them and how he trained them, you look at them and you say, why is our life so different from what they did? Why is our call so different than the call that they had in their life? Right? The Christian journey is well beyond just assuring our own salvation. If you look at Jesus' plan was not to just save the disciples, it was to enlist them. Jesus didn't just come up to his disciples and say, hey, I know you're fishing, I know you have your thing, I know you guys are busy. He said, all I'm asking you to do is come meet with me once or twice a week. Come, I'll teach you guys, I'll make sure that you're fed, I'll make sure that you're good, I'll make sure that you're growing, I have an accountability group, we'll check up on you, and we'll be good to go, and you can just keep going whatever you're doing. That's not what Jesus did. Jesus spent time with them every single day. He lived with them, he grew with them, he mentored them, he taught them, he trained them, he empowered them, and he ultimately commissioned them to do exactly what Jesus was doing. It wasn't like Jesus was up here doing all this and they were just like his fan group, following around just applauding him every time he did something. That's not what Jesus called them for. He didn't say, hey, I'll make sure you're fed and you just kind of follow me whenever you can. He says, no, I'm going to train you, I'm going to empower you, I'm going to grow you and mature you so that you can ultimately do exactly what I am doing. And what Jesus was doing, he was teaching, he was preaching, he was healing people, he was delivering them from circumstances in their life. And Jesus has called us to do exactly the same thing. All of his disciples are called to do exactly what Jesus was doing while he was here on the earth. The call to Christianity is more than just meeting in a building once or twice a week. The call to Christianity is a call to affect every single aspect of our life, every single minute of every single day. Whether we're at home, whether we're with our families, whether we're at work, whether we're doing our hobbies, whether we're on vacation, whatever it is, God says, in those moments, I'm asking you to follow after me and do what I am commissioning you to do. Do exactly what I would be doing in those moments. This is no more evident than the conversation that we started with in John chapter 21. Jesus was talking to Simon Peter. And the setting behind this is, Jesus had already died and he had resurrected. He was kind of making his rounds to all of his disciples. Not just these ones, but anybody that had been following him. He was just appearing and just teaching them kind of one last time. And in this moment, the disciples were out fishing, which I think is kind of interesting because Jesus had died and they were just kind of lost, right? But they had reverted to going back to what they had been doing before. They went back to what they were comfortable with. Jesus wasn't there with them physically, so they kind of like reverted back, like, well, what do we know how to do? Let's fish, right? And they were out there and they weren't catching anything. They had no luck. They'd just been throwing out their nets, and every time they pulled it back, it was empty. And then Jesus showed up on the scene, and Jesus provided a miracle for them. And Jesus fed them once again. And that conversation that we read followed. And three times Jesus asked if Peter loved him. And every time after Peter affirmed, he's like, of course, Jesus, of course I know. You know I love you. We've lived together these last several years during your ministry. We've had poured our blood and our tears and every bit of ourselves into this ministry. You know me. You know that I love you. And every single time Jesus responded, feed my sheep. Every time Peter affirmed him, you know I love you. Jesus said, all right, if you love me, feed my sheep. It was a challenge for Peter to go deeper. There was more to his relationship than just loving Jesus. Because Jesus says, if you love me, you will feed my sheep. And if we are his disciples, and I hope that you are this morning, I believe the same commission is extended to your life. I believe Jesus is looking at you and he's saying, do you love me? And I hope your response is yes this morning. And I believe Jesus' response back to you would be the same to Peter. He said, then feed my sheep. Because when we shift from sheep to shepherd, we ultimately take responsibility for someone else's spiritual growth or development. Our Christian walk is no longer focused on me and God. It's no longer focused on just ensuring my salvation, kind of just riding it out until I get to heaven. Just surviving until Jesus comes back. Our Christian relationship is much more than that. When we make this shift from sheep to shepherd, we take responsibility for somebody else's spiritual growth and development. And I believe nobody is excluded. I believe if you are a follower of Christ this morning, you are included in this commission. If you are Jesus' sheep, if God and Jesus are your shepherd this morning, then you have also been given the commission to do what Jesus did, to begin shepherding sheep. I think a lot of people, we get to this point and we start making excuses in our life. Like, I'm an introverted person. That's not me. I'm shy. I can't do that. That's what we have a pastor for. Right, I'm too busy. I've got all this stuff going on. I have a hard enough time just managing me and my own family. I can't take on somebody else's problems. And we just start making all these things. I've got this position. I've got this status. I've got all these things in my life that are important to me. Right, we start making these skills, but I believe regardless of wherever you're at in your life, regardless of if you're shy, or regardless of if you have talents in certain areas, regardless if you think somebody's better than you, Jesus has called you this morning to begin shepherding sheep. Jesus has called you to feed his sheep this morning. We are called to take responsibility, not only for ourselves, but for the spiritual lives of those around us. And I believe if we're not, we're missing out on what Jesus has called us to do. We're falling short of what he wants us in our relationship with him. So this morning we've established that we are to be a sheep, that that's a good thing. God is our shepherd. Jesus says it all the time, I'm the good shepherd. And there's so many Bible verses that kind of reference that relationship, so it's a good thing. We've also established that we are all called to shepherd. So this morning we're just going to end by taking a look at what it means to be a good shepherd and how we're to shepherd in our lives. So we're going to look at the qualities of a good shepherd this morning. Point number one, shepherds have compassion towards their sheep. This is one that kind of challenged me this morning. The more I thought about it, the more I meditated about it. If we are a follower of Christ, then we are all have been sheep at some point in our life. We have all been that young, dumb lamb that's just been running around like crazy. That takes a couple smacks in the head to get reminded of what we're doing. We have to get drugged by our neck someplace because we're about ready to run off a cliff. We've all been that little sheep in our life. And because we have that experience, we should know, we should understand what those sheep are going through. A good shepherd understands what's going on in the minds of their sheep because they've been there. We know the weaknesses, we know the limitations that they have. So when they mess up or stumble, we can show them mercy and grace instead of showing them judgment. Instead of casting them out or instead of ridiculing them, as a good shepherd, we look in their life and say, hey, I've been there. I've tripped over that same thing. I made that same stupid mistake. Let me help you. Let me show you the way. Good shepherds have compassion for their sheep. They speak truth and love to them, and they guide them back to where they need to be. Number two, shepherds know their sheep. They spend time with them. They live everyday life with them. Not just occasionally, not just when it works out. They make it a priority to invest in their life. They make it a priority to know who they are. They make it a priority to see what's going on in their life, to see what they need, to see how they can help them. They just invest in their life. They know their sheep. One of the Bible verses says, when Jesus is talking about us, he says, I know my sheep, and my sheep know me. And I believe that relationship should apply to the sheep that we have in our life. The sheep should know that you're there for them. The sheep should know that you care about them. by the way that you treat them, by the way that you act them, and what you pour into their life. And you should know your sheep. You should care and you should love about them, and you should invest into their lives. Shepherds know their sheep. Number three, shepherds are self-forgetful. When you look at the shepherds, it's kind of like this example, this illustration. The needs of the sheep always come before the need of the shepherd. They're willing to give up their safety, they're willing to give up their comfort, they're willing to give up whatever it is to protect their sheep. They're willing to sacrifice for the ultimate well-being of their flock. And so as good shepherds this morning, we should be willing to sacrifice in order to guarantee the well-being of those people that we are shepherding. The people that are young and growing in Christ. We should be willing to give up our comfort, give up our security, give up our time, give up our finances to ensure that they're getting to the place that they need to be. Shepherds are self-forgetful. We also want to look at how to care for your sheep. And this is kind of how we're going to close today. How to do this. How to take this message. All right, I understand that. I understand that I'm supposed to be a shepherd. Now we want to take this and we want to apply it to your life. How can you apply this to your life this morning? Number one, you must identify your sheep. If you understand this method, you understand that I'm supposed to be a shepherd, but if you never go out and identify who the sheep are in your life, you're never going to do anything. And here's the truth this morning. Every single one of you, if you are a follower of Christ, have somebody in your life right now that you can be shepherding. There's somebody in your circle of influence. There's somebody that you have contact with in your life on a weekly basis that you can shepherd. Whether it's family members, whether it's friends, whether it's kids, whether it's people here at church, whether it's people at your workplace, wherever it is, there's somebody in your life right now that needs someone to shepherd them. Somebody that needs somebody to kind of develop this relationship with them. So you need to identify your sheep. And I believe your problem, and my problem, I struggle with this myself, is we have to take responsibility for those sheep. We sit back so many times and we see it and God identifies it to us and we're like, well, somebody else will do that. Well, maybe I'll just introduce them to the pastor. This person will be so much better at doing that than me. I don't want to mess things up. I'm afraid of messing things up. I don't want to make them go in the wrong direction. And we're just so afraid to take responsibility that we just keep deflecting it. The first step to becoming a shepherd is identifying that you have sheep in your life that need shepherding. We must take responsibility for those God has placed in our lives. Don't assume that others will do it, or don't assume that those sheep will just figure it out on their own. Don't just assume that they won't figure it out, because the truth is, without guidance, I wouldn't have figured it out. And as Christians, you guys wouldn't have figured it out either, if there wouldn't have been somebody there that had taken you under their wing. Number two, shepherds must feed their sheep. You must use your influence in your life to be more than just a friend to them. I believe you should be a friend, that you should know them, you should care about them. But you should be more concerned about their spiritual well-being than the good feelings you have for one another. I hope that makes sense this morning. But you need to use your influence to ensure that they're growing in their relationship with God. Not just being their friend, not just being their buddy, but use your relationship to help advance and grow and help them mature in their relationship with God. Talk about spiritual things with them. Keep each other accountable. This is something I've been trying to push with the teens a lot of times because I believe talking about spiritual things in our relationships has just become so awkward because we never do it. It seems so out of place. We seem like we're shoving something down their throat. We seem like we're just like those people like, oh, he's bringing up Jesus again. Here he goes again. But it's because we've never taken the time to develop that habit in our life. And what you find is that the more you talk about spiritual things, the easier it becomes. Once you break through that first awkward barrier of asking how somebody's doing in their relationship with God, it gets much easier.